Testing. Is that picking up?
He would just take his headphones off.
Oh, I know. So
put your headphones back on.
It's all right, yeah.
It's coming through the audio meeting, so that's good.
Is this working now? You picking this up? Yep. I'll switch off then.
So we'll thank Cambridge Dean Tech. Actually, I've sent him we've got a big delegation of Indian business people coming over at the beginning of August, and we've got a. So hopefully that works.
Do I need to put a date in my diary?
Possibly.
So how are you otherwise?
just testing. Carly, I've emailed you. Can you just confirm that the live link is working over in Peterborough? Thank you. I'm muting the speech so you don't just hear our background noise. But if you can email me or tweet me just to say it's working in Peterborough, thank you.
Testing, testing. 1, 2. 1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2. Testing, testing. 1, 2. Testing, testing. 1, 2. 1, 2. 1, 2.
Testing, testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, testing, testing. Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing once again.
Testing, testing, 1, 2, 1, 2. Testing, 1, 2. One, two, one, two, testing.
Testing, 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 1, 2, 3, testing. Hello, hello. Hello.
Be starting in a couple of minutes. It's all right, everyone goes quiet.
Well, welcome to the Mayoral Hustings on the environment, climate change and sustainability. It's lovely to see so many of you here on a really nice evening. That's the start of the school holidays. So this event has been organised by Cambridge Carbon Footprint together with Anglia Ruskin University, to whom we're very grateful for these wonderful facilities, with the support of Peterborough Environment City Trust and in association with Cambridge Clean Tech. So our collective aim in putting on this event was to give our mayoral candidates an opportunity to hear the views of the electorate on the environment, climate change and sustainability, and to help us all decide how to vote. So before I start, I just want to do a little housekeeping. We're not expecting a fire practice, so if you hear the fire alarm, it's time to leave. The best way is out through that door, and there'll be some doors. The doors immediately on your left will be open. If for some strange reason you can't get out that way, you can get out that way and then go either to the left or to the right. And for those at the back, there's also a door, a fire exit at the back, and follow the signs. If anybody needs the toilets, it's probably easiest, if you're towards the front, is to go out that door and follow around the curvy wall round to there. Please put your phones on silent. There are rather small Wi-Fi instructions there. There is also a hearing loop, so if that's useful to you, do the appropriate thing to make it work for you. The event is being live streamed to Peterborough, where PECT are hosting a parallel event. So we'll be taking questions from both Peterborough and Cambridge, and from Twitter, and we've got some by email. So please be patient if you don't get a chance to get your question asked immediately. We'll also be taking some photos, so if you don't want your photo used, please let the photographers know, one of whom is Alana, who I can't see. She's just outside, okay. Well, if you see anybody taking a photo and you don't want to have your photo used, please tell them. You can also tweet your questions and comments to hashtag CPMayor17. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Aled, head of the Global Sustainability Institute here at Anglia Ruskin, who will be chairing the event. Thank you.
Thanks, Anne. So I'll just say a few words of welcome, and thank you all for turning up here in Cambridge. And for our colleagues over in Peterborough as well, it's great to have a sort of live streaming between the two places. So lots of people here in Cambridge, we know we've got lots of people in Peterborough as well. So I'll just say a few words about how we're going to make the evening work. We're also live on the Anglia Ruskin YouTube channel, where I've just checked and we have 7 viewers in addition to the ones in the room. So we can take their questions as well. And it may just be the people who are checking that it works. Welcome to Anglia Ruskin. Obviously, the topic for the evening is environment, sustainability, climate change, which we think is very important, but I'm a professor of sustainability, so I would say that. And I think it's obviously a key issue for the region. It's great we've got so many people turning out today. It's great that all the candidates decided it was an important topic to engage with and have come today. We invited all of the people we know who are standing for mayor, and Stephen Goldbink, who is the English Democrat candidate, unfortunately got a virus today, so pulled out at the last minute. UKIP declined the invite at the beginning. Everyone else has accepted. Unfortunately, Julie, who's the actual Green Party candidate, is also ill, but Jeremy has stepped in to take her place. Each of the candidates will be given 3 minutes to talk a little bit about their environment sustainability vision, what they want to be doing as mayor to start with. We'll go in alphabetical order by party. Following that, we'll take a round of questions from the Cambridge audience, and then we'll be getting a round of questions from the Peterborough audience, which is being collected by paper and then will be emailed over to me. So I'm not being rude looking at my email during the evening. I'm actually trying to engage with all the Peterborough guests as well. You can also tweet your questions using the hash CPMayor17 hashtag, and we'll have a round of Twitter questions as well towards the end. So please do tweet your questions if you don't get a chance initially. Just to say a couple of things about The mayor, obviously, elections are on May the 4th, and it brings together quite an interesting region between Cambridgeshire and Peterborough. The key areas, obviously, for the combined authority will be transport and housing in terms of budget, but then also skills, and also really, where do we go next? What is devolution going to look like over the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years? So this vision for what the region could be. We've heard Theresa May, the Prime Minister, talking about increasing power to the Welsh, Scottish and Northern Ireland assemblies and executives through devolution, increasing power. London is already talking about more power. Certainly those areas with devolution deals are already talking about actually what they want to see coming forward in the future. So hopefully some of the mayors will reflect not just on the powers they may have on May the 5th, but also the powers they may have in 5, 10 or 15 years' time. So that sort of vision would be really interesting. It is particularly interesting for us at the GSI because we've also got some funding from Sustainability East, which I also chair, bring Lauren, who is over there waving, if you can see that in Peterborough, not quite, but she'll come and say hello to everyone in Peterborough at some time, who's a PhD student who'll be looking at this sort of vision for the devolution area and trying to engage with all of you, so the citizens, various stakeholders, to try and understand what our vision for a devolution area is, talking to the local authorities, the city councils, the county councils, all the various local authorities around what their visions are, local businesses. So how do we actually think this new power that we might have in the region, what it can do for us. In terms of the sort of Dimbleby or Paxman running for the evening, I will try and make sure you stick to time. If you go way over your 3 minutes, I will come and grab the microphone off you. We have one microphone so that we can avoid people shouting at each other, or at least people in Peterborough won't be able to hear you shouting at each other. So we will try and pass the microphone amongst the candidates. If we can try and ask, if you're asking questions, certainly from the floor in Cambridge, please try and make them questions, not statements, especially not long statements. You're very welcome to talk to the candidates afterwards to make your statements, but if we can get questions so we can get as many questions in as possible, that would be great. And also for the candidates, if you could keep your responses to the questions as short as you possibly can, so we can get through a lot of questions, that would be really useful. So, without wanting to delay things any further, I'm going to switch off that so we can concentrate on the candidates' responses. But I will ask James and the Conservative Party to kick off with our 3 minute statement. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. My name is James Palmer, and I am the Conservative candidate for Mayor of Cambridgeshire and Peterborough. Thank you very much for asking me along this evening, and hello, Peterborough, if you can see me over there. I think we have to be brutally honest about what devolution is, or what government asked of this county through devolution. It is a deal. A deal is a two-way street. Government have given us £770 million, and they have a clear growth agenda. That means that Cambridgeshire has a clear growth agenda. That means that new roads, new rail, new infrastructure across the county, and wherever you live in Cambridgeshire and Peterborough, your needs are different. The job of the mayor is to implement the new housing, the new roads, and the new rail, of course, in an environmentally sound way, and look at the options of providing the best possible solution to the problem we have before us, without destroying the wonderful and beautiful nature of the fantastic county that we all live in at the moment. Something is very close to my heart. As leader of East Cambridgeshire District Council, I brought in a new bin service, which increased recycling from under 40% to well over 60, I think 65.7 or something like that. So we went from the worst to amongst the best in the county. Not only that, we put in a new park in Ely, open space for everybody to enjoy. And, of course, our community land trust scheme, low-density housing, high ecology housing with the best possible open space as well. So there is more than one way to achieve what we need to achieve. We must always be mindful of the environment when we are putting in new infrastructure. But we can't hide away from the facts that getting around this county is utterly horrendous. The infrastructure is lagging behind the rest of the county. We have to improve it. Here in Cambridge, of course, I vocally consistently shouted and will continue to do so for an underground system and a light railway to link the county with this great city. Protecting the sitting of this country, protecting the setting, and protecting also the setting of our rural towns and villages. Very, very important. But it depends where you are. In Fenland, I was up in Fenland yesterday. They are desperate for the M11 to be extended through the heart of the county. They want to be linked, and they deserve to be linked, and we need them to, because the South can't take all the growth. So we have to look at what is needed and what is necessary across this great county. That's the job of the mayor. The job of the mayor is to cross every T and dot every I and do things responsibly and properly with a mind to the environment, but also with a mind to the great economy that we have. Providing a future for the people of Cambridgeshire and for their children and grandchildren. Making sure that Cambridgeshire is the very top of the international list when companies come to invest here. It can be done, and it must be done, and it will be done. And I am the person who can do it. Thank you.
Good evening. The environment and climate change and sustainability, this is clearly home territory for the Greens. The phrase I'm trying to avoid using here is the much overused phrase, it's in our DNA. It's a horrible phrase anyway, but it's actually more fundamental than that, because it's actually the very reason for our existence as a political party. So the Green vision is that problems are most effectively tackled if we take the widest possible view. And so we need to start from the position that we share one planet, and we need to work out all our policy decisions from that point. That may seem rather distant, but we will get down to a local level in a minute. The point about the planet is that we don't own it. For all our wealth, we can't go out and buy a new one when we have finished trashing this one. That's the most fundamental political fact of our era. But actually, if you listen to other political parties, you would very likely miss it. So, Brexit is no defense against rising sea levels, and even if we had no immigrants at all, Britain would still be subject to the extreme weather that global warming is already bringing us. At current rates of emission, we have about 20 years left of putting carbon into the atmosphere before we reach the maximum that we would be allowed that's consistent with a 2-degree rise in temperatures. And so that has huge political implications. And it's true that the changes that we therefore need to contemplate are vast, and we shouldn't minimize the scale of the effort that will be needed. But there is good news too. It is that our lives, all of our lives, will be better if we work together to make that transition. And that is what the Green Party is standing for, and that is why we are asking for your vote. So to come down to the scale of things at this election, the county and things like that, some of the issues that will be involved. So if we commit ourselves, for example, to ensuring that the buses in our cities are electric, then we will solve many of the problems of air pollution as well as the problems of congestion. If we exert ourselves to create networks of segregated cycle paths, we'll address issues of health as well as of transport. On our farmland, if we ban bee-killing pesticides, we will increase biodiversity and the richness of our countryside, as well as safeguarding the pollinators that are necessary to maintaining our food supplies. If we build real homes and not just Lego houses, real communities where people care for each other, we will address the crisis in social care as well as the crisis in housing. And while we're doing it, of course, we need to make those homes sustainable. We need to reintroduce the zero carbon homes standard that was abandoned by the current government last year. You might like to ask Councillor Palmer if he would favour that. So everything is connected. Everything is connected. That's the green vision. Thank you.
Thank you. Some years ago, I wrote a book called The New Noah, where I did a survey of the challenges that mankind faced and concluded that they're actually a lot worse than most of our politicians and indeed our scientists will tell us. I'm actually very pessimistic. To make things worse, when I looked at our political processes, I also concluded that they weren't up to fix it. And indeed, for the last 6-7 years, we've seen our political class fumble the ball on climate change and just about every other sustainable issue. So what does one do? Well, you can do the right thing by yourself. I've got the electric car, I cycle, I use public transport when I can, I don't travel too much, but it doesn't actually make any difference at all because some other person will just go off and use that petrol instead of you. So what we've got to do is completely transform, and we can do that by demonstration, and we can demonstrate that in Cambridge. So when we talk about transportation in Cambridge, we don't talk about electric cars, we talk about electric velocycles, very lightweight single-person electric vehicles which use a tenth of the power of a traditional car. And that's what the Cambridge Electric Transport Corporation has just put a bid on the Indiegogo site to raise funds. As mayor, what I would do is use just 20 million of that 700 million to buy 10,000 of these vehicles and distribute them or make them available in Cambridge. All of a sudden, we have a transformational change on transport in Cambridge. All our roads become 4 lanes wide. So we can, it's such a massive change. Similarly, when it comes to housing, you can huff and puff, or you can go off and make sure that the new houses are to the best specification. And you don't do that by making things out of sticks and bricks, which is what virtually all of the houses that we have in Cambridge at the moment. You make them in a factory to a very high specification, which is very consistent. You ship them down. The great thing is, like the cars, the little cars being cheaper than regular cars, these houses are less expensive as well. And these are things that the mayor can do. Another thing that the mayor can do is actually make sure that our spatial planning is sustainable. You don't scatter housing around the county. You concentrate it. People like living in dense, service-rich communities. That's why houses in the centre of towns are way more expensive than the suburbs. The only reason people with families go out into the country is it's the first house they can afford. So what we can do is, as mayor, is actually spatially plan and make sure that what we build are sustainable new towns rather than scattering it randomly across, what's it, across the county. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. I'm going to stay where I am. It's quicker than to sit down, and I'll get my 3 minutes in. So as it's been said, I only have 3 minutes to talk about how I think the role of the mayor relates to the key environment, climate change and sustainability issues across Cambridgeshire and Peterborough. So this is going to be a bit of a whistle-stop tour touching on some key areas. Firstly, and to set our area into a national context, there are real challenges in the shape of government policy, both in the UK and internationally with the election of Donald Trump, and in dealing with Brexit. For example, the failure of the Green Deal scheme, which formed a key part of the Cambridgeshire Action on Energy Partnership, reflects a wider failure by the government since 2010 to take the lead on tackling climate change and environmental issues. The government also needs to make sure that existing environment protections are defended and even extended as we go through Brexit, as well as replacing vital European funding that we are set to lose. The mayor, therefore, will have an important role in challenging government on the wider policy context, as well as supporting and challenging member councils on the combined authority on a local level. Now, I think we need a wider representation in the combined authority itself than is currently the case. So I would also like to see it include key representatives on its board and committees of a wide range of voluntary, community and environmental groups, as well as the LEP. The combined authority area comprises urban and rural communities, and here needs to explore and understand the differing needs of both. Now, I'm impressed by Peterborough's ambitious plans to be the environment capital of the UK and the first circular city, and I would like to explore if the circular city vision could be used for Cambridge and also how it might translate into our market towns. But we need a strong and sustainable countryside. Fenland produces 37% of the vegetables grown in England. So as a district, it is very important for our food security. But also, of course, it also has high levels of deprivation and health inequality. We need to tackle the lack of affordable housing and poor transport in rural communities if we want a truly sustainable rural economy, and if we want to tackle the poverty and deprivation that impacts on so many communities. On transport, I want to use the powers of the Bus Services Bill to radically improve bus services across Cambridgeshire and Peterborough. 2/3 of journeys on public transport in the UK are taken by bus, and improving buses will benefit our young people, our older people, disabled people, the low paid and job seekers, all of whom are more likely to use buses. I want to use the Mayor's franchising powers to specify vehicle emission requirements, invest in gaps in the network, and introduce smart ticketing. On housing, we must provide genuinely affordable housing for rent for those who can't ever afford to buy through enabling councils and housing associations to build homes, or using community-led housing schemes like the East Cam's model of community land trusts. But we also need to tackle fuel poverty by building energy-efficient new homes, and I would like to gain agreement on a large-scale retrofit scheme to tackle older stock, particularly that in the private rented sector. Thank you.
So this region faces a number of major once-in-a-lifetime challenges. Brexit. In my view, it will be life-changing for us. Climate change, it could be life-threatening unless we act now. The challenge for the mayor is to deliver growth, but that growth needs to be delivered on a sustainable basis. And as I listen to people across the region, they are concerned about what we are doing to our environment. And as mayor, I believe that I have the right skills and the real life experience to actually put sustainability at the heart of everything that I do. And why is that? Because I believe I have a track record of deliverability on sustainable issues as a city councillor here in Cambridge. Be that the laying the foundation for the 200 sustainable homes that are currently being built, 50% affordable, be that protecting the open spaces undertaking material investment in new tree planting, providing additional allotments, which were much needed, or promoting cycling as the city's cycle champion. So, for me, if I was mayor, I would deliver on climate change. I would deliver sustainable communities, sustainable jobs, sustainable homes, and sustainable transport. And I would achieve it with three simple measures. First, to ensure that sustainability is built into everything the mayor and the combined authority do. Second, to ensure that the housing funding that we received acts as a platform for delivering sustainable homes. And third, to ensure that the transport measures that the mayor has will deliver sustainable transport solutions focused on rail, bus, and cycling, and embracing new technology like electric vehicles. It's in the interest of all of us, for our children and future generations, that the growth of the region is delivered on a sustainable basis. Thank you.
Thank you. So thank you for each of the candidates for sticking to time. So the first thing we'll do is we will take a round of questions from people in the audience in Cambridge. So if you want to put your hands up, then I will take a few. We'll probably start at this side and then we'll come over there. There's hands up right there. So we'll take one question right here with a pink scarf just there. We'll do three questions and then, we'll do three questions and then we'll come back to the candidates. So we'll take one for the pink scarf there, and then I think we'll go round up there because there was quite a few up in there. So.
Okay, I'm asking a question that was part of Transition Cambridge, so I'm asking on behalf of somebody else, but I'm part of Transition Cambridge. This ocean plastic is an urgent problem. There's mounting evidence that fish and other wildlife mistake plastic particles for food and ingest it, which not only kills animals, but brings plastic into our own food chain. If the plastic entering the ocean continues at the present rate, there will be more plastic than fish by 2050. Every piece of plastic in the ocean starts as rubbish on land. Our roads, motorways... Sorry?
What's the question?
Okay. We need to do something about recycling. So what does the mayor intend to do to combat plastic pollution in our communities, landscapes and waterways?
Great, thank you. So there was a hand up at the back. So the gentleman with the hand up there. And then we'll take the one in the middle up there.
Okay, it's a question to all the candidates. Why do we need a mayor, basically? What's wrong with it? What's wrong with the existing power structures?
Okay.
Delivering the benefits of devolution.
Thank you. I'll come back and I'll rephrase that one specifically for this evening. Question in the middle.
Yeah, Marcus Gearing, full disclosure, I'm a Lib Dem councillor. I was wondering what the candidates thought about the danger that particulate matter poses to the city centres of this region, given that NOx and pollution levels of particulate matters have gone up drastically through the increase of diesel cars. Are you contemplating measures like Westminster Council instituted?
Great, thank you. So, brilliant, thank you. And then we've got Peterborough have already sent through some questions for the next round. So the first three questions, one on plans for recycling, in particular around plastic. The other one is, why do we need a mayor? If we can think specifically about why do we need a mayor, environment, sustainability, obviously transport and housing, that's pretty much everything. So why do we need a mayor? Particulate matter, local pollution, any ideas and plans for that? So if we can take, Kevin, are you happy to go first?
Yes, thank you. I think we have to be aware of the powers that the mayor actually has, as opposed to the powers that perhaps we would like the mayor to have. And when we're talking about recycling, as the first questioner has, all the constituent parts of the combined authority, the district authorities, are already doing recycling. And I would imagine that will continue, and they have that role. The role of the mayor over the combined authority is largely to chair this, is to ensure that the all the constituent parts of the combined authority are working well together. And if that means getting them all together and working out ways of recycling better, then I think that is probably something the mayor could do, but a mayor has no powers over that. Question two, why do we need a mayor? Well, largely because there was a deal. There was, the proposal for devolution, and the government would not shift. They shifted on a few things, but they would not shift on whether there was going to be a mayor or not. Now, you can call it a mayor, you can call it the chair of the combined authority. I mean, in the end, it becomes a name, but it is somebody that is going to ensure that all the local authorities in the combined authority area are working better together and you know, combining their resources and lobbying government as a single entity with a you know, rather than as they do now, six different authorities. And the measures on local pollution. Now, a lot of that, where you were talking, Marcus, about specifically about the centre of Cambridge, I think, a lot of that's being done by and through the city deal. And the city deal is there, and it's separate from the combined authority, but the mayor will work alongside the city deal. The mayor is not going to take over from the city deal or impose things on the city deal. I would envisage working very closely with them with a view to dealing with pollution in the centre of Cambridge and other places too, but you were specific about the city.
Peter.
Okay. As far as the pollutions are concerned, I think that the mayor has got to take advice and discourage the use within the council and set example. I see no reason why the microplastics in cleaners needs to be used within the council. I think I've already covered the particulate matter in that the solution, I believe, is light electric cars, and that we can actually make that transition very quickly in a few years rather than the tens of years that we'd need to deploy transit systems of the sort. When it comes to why a mayor, it's because councils have stopped working. Government has given stuff to council. That's why we have city deals and bids and what have you. These used to be done by councils. They've lost the trust of the government. I actually believe they've lost the trust of the electorate and business as well. So we needed a change. Having an elected mayor will change it so long as we elect a mayor who isn't out of the council. I.e. an independent person like me. because I honestly believe that we've got to reinvent local government, and this is a one-off opportunity for us to do it, because I just don't see local government working at all currently.
Rod. I'm mixing the order up so that you all have it.
Just on coming on the first question in relation to plastic, I think at two levels. Firstly, I think the introduction from the coalition government in relation to plastic bags is an illustration of what action can be taken, and a very effective action can be taken. And I think the role of the mayor as part of that sustainability programme is around ensuring that you can introduce those types of measures.
and going beyond necessarily the remit in terms of what the devolved, narrow devolved powers that the mayor has. In relation to why need a mayor, there's a very good reason why you need a mayor. You need someone who's going to be a strong voice for this region with national government. With Brexit, this government could potentially roll back material environmental legislation that has been built on over the last 40 years as part of a European platform. And the mayor needs to be that strong voice stopping this government from doing that type of action and actually acting as a journey through Brexit, as that voice through the Brexit journey to ensure that this region is protected. So that's why I think there is a need for a mayor. And then finally, on the point in relation to particle matters, I think there is a need in relation to transport for the mayor to deliver a comprehensive strategy in terms of all modes of transport. That's delivering sustainable transport where necessarily, electric buses. London has ordered 70 electric buses. I don't see why we should not be able to order and effectively run electric buses in the region. It also includes rail, it also includes smart ticketing, it also includes looking where necessarily to undertake some additional road work expansion. So for example, the Girton Interchange is a very good example where that project would actually deliver an efficient use of modal movement between cars coming from the west going to the south.
Thank you. James.
Thank you. Interestingly, the plastic bottle issue is something that resonates with me. I was, for many, many years, my family business was milk delivery, and we delivered milk to homes between in Suffolk all the way up to Cambridgeshire, and many thousands of bottles of milk a day, glass bottles, did we deliver, and of course, totally sustainable. We delivered as many as possible in electric vehicles, but tax-free plastic bottles, which everybody could nip to the supermarket and buy, obviously killed my business along with many other things. I would lobby government, but as mayor I wouldn't have control on doing this, but I would lobby government for a tax on plastic bottles. I think that's entirely feasible. But what can we do locally? Well, we're tied into the minerals and waste policy that the current county council has, which is, in my opinion, a bad policy. I'm a huge advocate for incineration and AD, and I certainly, what we're trying to do at East Cams is come out. We will be asking through devolution to come out of the minerals and waste policy of the county council, put an incineration and AD plant next to new housing, incinerate waste and garden waste will go into the AD, creating gas for the housing, and the hot water from the incineration producing electricity pumped around the houses produces heating for the houses. Entirely sustainable for the environment, of course, but also something that can work very well for the people who live in the area. So that's the first one. Why do we need a mayor? We need somebody to stand up for this county, east, west, north and south. This county needs somebody speaking up for it to government and to international business, encouraging business to come here, encouraging government to do the very best for this county. Government are interested in Cambridgeshire. They see it as a driver for the economy, but they need one person to speak to. They need a voice for Cambridgeshire, speaking out for everybody. That's why we need a mayor. The current system doesn't work. A mayor for Cambridgeshire will, as long as we have the right mayor. Measures to halt diesel cars in Cambridge. Well, as is mentioned, this isn't something the mayor will have direct influence over. And I'm interested by your mention of Westminster. But of course, Westminster can make these changes because people have got a viable option of getting into London another way. At this moment in time, we haven't got a viable option of getting into Cambridge. And for all Peter's lovely idea of electric cycles, there's more people coming to Cambridge every day than 10,000, I'm afraid. And also, getting them to Cambridge in a car, getting out of a car, getting on a cycle, not really realistic. I'm an advocate of an underground for Cambridge. It protects the beauty of our city. It's totally realistic. It gives people an option, and it will cut down traffic in the centre. People need to get in and out and across this great city. An underground will solve that problem, and if I'm elected, I will begin work on that from day one. Thank you.
Thank you. Jeremy.
Thank you. Taking the questions in order, the issue of plastic, I think it is vital that on a national scale we have a scheme for having a deposit on plastic bottles. There are schemes in Scandinavia that have reduced the amount of plastic waste going into the sea dramatically by having a deposit and then reverse vending machines in supermarkets and other places where people can either take their bottles or children can collect them or things like that. The second question, why do we need a mayor? We don't. The Green Party was the only party on the City Council to vote against this proposal. We don't buy the government's agenda about so-called devolution. It's actually a way of imposing a centralised, growth-based agenda on the people of Cambridgeshire, and we don't buy that. Thirdly, the matter of pollution, particulate matter and nitrogen oxide pollution in the city centre. There was a report from the Director of Public Health to the County Council Health Services Committee earlier this month that said that across the county there are 250 excess deaths caused by this sort of pollution. The way to do it is in attempting to tackle congestion, not to put more people onto diesel-powered buses, but to get electric buses, as has already been said. And as has already been said, it is possible, Stagecoach faced with that suggestion said that it was impractical. It's rubbish. It is being done in London. There are two routes that are entirely electric already, and by 2020, Transport for London will have all the buses in central London, either hybrid buses or electric ones. That can be done. The mayor can do that by taking advantage of the franchising powers in the bus services bill, which will give similar powers to the mayor as Transport for London do there.
Thank you, Jeremy. So we will take a round of questions from Peterborough. They've been coming in thick and fast, which is great. So three questions from the Peterborough. We have a lot of councillors in Peterborough asking questions. So question first from Darren Fowler, Councillor Darren Fowler, on noise pollution. Any plans or thoughts around how to tackle noise pollution, especially around residential dwellings? Picking up on that last point, we've had a number of questions actually in advance, and at least three or four questions coming in from Peterborough, and are probably questions in the audience as well, around bus services, and would the mayor anticipate using the potential power to take over the franchising? And we've heard a little bit about that now. So bus services and franchising, plans around that. And then another question around actually more the rural area of our region. So any thoughts or plans around the unique features of the rural area, our woodland cover, which is one of the lowest in the country, or the Great Fen project? How do you see the development of the rural side playing out, either from a sort of conservation perspective or a infrastructure development perspective? So to start that off, if we could start with Rod.
In relation to the first question, noise pollution, I think that the mayor does have a role in terms of the housing delivery programme. So the mayor is able to influence that in terms of good quality, well-built, sustainable homes. And I think that goes to the heart of some of the issues that we have in terms of some of the communities that have been delivered in recent years, is actually the quality of those communities fall well short of what we should be demanding of the developers, of people who actually build these communities. So I think that's an opportunity to do something in relation to noise pollution. In terms of bus services, I think they are a critical component in terms of delivering an integrated transport strategy for this region. What we have seen over the course of the last 5 years is a material erosion in the provision of bus services into the rural communities. That's leaving people isolated, and it's leaving people feeling as though they cannot connect in terms of the broader community. The key thing that needs to be done is an audit of those bus services. The greater Cambridge City Deal have started that exercise, and that needs to also take place elsewhere in the region. The mayor then does have the power, the franchising power, to actually transform those bus services so that they operate in unison with other modes of transport, such as trains, such as cycling, such as walking.
to enable us to actually get around much more efficiently. And I think that is a critical opportunity that the mayor has as part of the powers. The rural setting and infrastructure, I think it comes back to sustainable communities. You know, there are material plans coming forward for large settlements across the region. I mean, 10,000 homes at Wisbeach. Now, those people, there aren't 10,000 jobs at Wisbeach. So where are those people going to work? They're either going to come down the A10 or across on the A47 to jobs in Peterborough or around Peterborough or to the south of the region. And that is not sustainable. We cannot go down that route of development. So what we need to do is we need to put jobs in communities so that actually the public transport and the infrastructure comes next and then the homes. And some people will say, well, actually, the mayor can't do that because they have no powers. Well, actually, the mayor does have some powers, because although the mayor does not have control over SIL, which is Community Infrastructure Levy, the mayor has some money each year that he can actually use to actually match that SIL investment to ensure that councils actually deliver the infrastructure before the homes. We've seen it, I'm sure you've seen it, across the region. We are having communities built where there is no transport infrastructure. It's crazy. It's got to stop.
Thank you. Kevin.
Yes, thank you. In terms of noise pollution, if we're talking about ensuring within new built homes, for instance, I mean, I've got something here beside me, the Cambridgeshire Sustainable Housing Guide, that I've become partly through the Housing Development Agency, and I, you know, so we will be looking at using that to build homes that are properly insulated that would that will have the effect of not having noise pollution from them. On the question of a bus franchising, when I think buses are hugely underrated. The first of these Hustings that we all did was to a group of property developers. And I spoke about buses, and question was asked about how many of them there felt, you know, that if buses were important. And there wasn't a single hand went up. I'm sure you're not surprised at that, as I know we weren't. Well, yes, yeah, that's very true. Yes, but it was no one in the audience for that, and I think that comes about because the people in the main that I spoke about earlier that are travelling on the bus, there is nobody speaking up for the bus users. You know, there are plenty of pressure groups and residents associations that are speaking on behalf of people in all sorts of ways, but there is no one speaking up for the bus users. So I think because nobody's speaking up for them, people tend to think that they're not needed, and we know there are. So Rod talked about the bus franchising powers that the mayor will have, and that will be something I will be very, very keen to be pursuing, because I do think that's one way. And I'm not talking about the sorts of buses that are driving around and polluting everywhere now, but we're talking about decent electric buses. The unique features of the of rural areas. Now, when I had lots of spare time. For some reason, I don't seem to have much of that at the moment. But I spend a lot of time out and about and in Cambridgeshire in the countryside with a camera. I like to go out and take photographs of wildlife and just landscapes in general. So I think it's no, not buses. But I so, but I, you know, I do think it's important that if we are going to build new towns, wherever, you know, new towns, new extensions of village, we have to ensure that there are areas for people living locally to go to for recreation, to sit and to walk through and to enjoy.
Thank you. James.
Yeah, thank you. Noise pollution in residential dwellings, that's a matter of lobbying government for better insulation on housing, and the mayor can do that, but so can every political party, and that's something we can look at. Bus services and franchising. There seems to be, and there always is a belief by people who live in cities, that the countryside is desperate for rural buses. In actual fact, there's a good reason why there isn't a rural bus service, is because it's totally and utterly impractical. And if you want to get anywhere on a bus in the countryside, you've got to have all day to get there and get home again, because it has to stop at every town and every village on its way to its destination. It's a totally impractical idea. And as I said earlier, I was in Fenland last night, and somebody stood up and spoke to me and said, please, please, please don't waste money on putting rural bus services into Cambridgeshire. And I agree with them. What we need is a better connected Cambridgeshire, not expensive buses chugging around the countryside with four or five people on. It's totally and utterly ridiculous to suggest that's the right way to go. And I will not be putting rural buses into our extreme rural areas. It's really the wrong way to go, and it would be a waste of money and time. I do believe in community buses, though, and I've backed them at East Cams as leader, and I think they've got a real place to go to help out those who are in need of a service, and community buses do work for communities and for elderly people. But just putting bus routes through villages, it's absolutely not for me, and I won't be doing it. Rural area development is something that is close to my heart, and as I mentioned earlier, sympathetic rural development with open spaces, low density where possible, alongside strong communities that exist already, is the way to go forward. I don't agree with Mr. Dore and his idea of sticking brand new cities and towns all over the countryside. I do believe in using what is sustainable. If there is a town with a railway station, utilise that transport. If there is a town with already good links, you utilise that by building near it. But what you do not do is destroy the very aspect of our countryside. Cambridgeshire is a massive county. It has acres and acres and acres of open land that is suitable for development, that's just alongside towns and cities. But it doesn't mean to say you have to build over every square inch, nor do you need to. We can expand this county as we need to. There is a great housing need. It's obvious if you have to earn £115,000 to build a house in Cambridge, there is a problem. And we all know there is a problem, and it's a lack of housing. And we have to be honest about that. Sustainable development in the countryside with proper transport links, a light railway linking in the county, railway services enhanced, is the way to go. Building new towns and cities across the county isn't my favourite option. Thank you.
Thank you. Jeremy.
Thank you. On the subject of noise pollution, at the risk of sounding like a cracked record, electric vehicles don't make as much noise. Secondly, properly insulated houses are better at containing noise. On the subject of bus services, as I've already said, we're in favour of using the franchising powers that the bus services bill give to tackle those issues. Additionally, we think that the workplace parking levy should be used to generate funds to subsidise public transport. For years before, the city deal was talking about actually addressing congestion by means of closing roads or other silly ideas like that. The Green Party were talking about investigating a congestion charge. We think actually that a more subtle and nuanced road pricing scheme would be better, because then traffic flows can be managed more sensitively. And then thirdly, as far as things like fens and woodland goes, again, it's very close to the green heart. The consciousness of our natural environment isn't something that's just nice for people who like that sort of thing. It's actually integral to who we are. We are materially poorer if we just live our lives through the screens of our smartphones. Thank you.
Thank you. Peter.
My experience of noise pollution, especially with electric cars, is actually from road noise. And that what we need to do is actually repair our roads. What's been happening is that the cost saved has been transferred to you in repairs to your car. So having better roads will actually mean quieter roads, and maybe your cars will last a bit longer as well. In terms of bus services, I think we've got to be much more radical in the rural areas as well. What we can do is have interurban services using coaches between Peterborough, Huntingdon, Cambridge, Wisbeach and the like, with very limited numbers of stops on those trunk roads. But then use feeder buses, probably on an on-demand basis, like the community buses, to take people that those last 4 or 5 miles between home and the rapid, comfortable trunk services. I'm sure this is a way of providing public transport to the rural communities for everyone, not just those desperate enough to be willing to sit around all day at home waiting for a bus or on a bus. As far as protecting the rural areas concerned, the washes are already suffering from sea level rise. It's not the high tides that the washes are suffering from, it's the low tides. It's more difficult for it to drain. And over the next 50 years, I sincerely expect that we will have a storm surge that will inundate most of the fens, an ecological disaster of desperate proportions. And that's why for the last 20 years, I've been vainly promoting the building of a barrier across the Wash from Hunstanton to Skegness to protect our fens from seawater. I'm just terrified that our village's water beach and land beach have been named prescient.
Thank you. So we'll take another round of questions from the room in Cambridge. We'll take it from up this. There's quite a few hands that went up there in the first place as well. So the gentleman in with a pink shirt.
Given we live in the driest part of the UK, are you confident that there will be enough water to accommodate all the planned growth without harming the natural environment?
Thank you. And then the gentleman with the red jumper just behind. Yep, there. Yes.
I'm wondering how much influence you guys are going to have over Highways England, who seem to have been let off the leash by Chris Grayling. The number of road schemes, I'm a volunteer with CPRE, Campaign to Protect Rural England. The number of road schemes that are coming out for consultation and the number of road schemes that are being built at the moment are overwhelming. I understand that you want to get better connectivity, but if you look at the consultation for the duelling of the A428 between Caxton Gibbet and the Black Cat roundabout, one of those options is just cut through virgin countryside. What influence will you guys have over Highways England?
Thank you. And then a lady here.
Can I ask the different candidates' position on the use of neonicotinoids with crops in the rural parts of our county? As you've been pointing out, we do have a very high yielding part of the county, part of the country, nationally speaking. And I understand the farmers are concerned about their yields if they don't use neonicotinoids, but the longer term prospects are actually quite bad for the yields, I'd have thought, if they do. So I'd like to hear what the candidates' positions are on that, please.
Thank you. So three questions. So one on water and the future of water for the region. The other one on powers over Highways England. And then a question on neonicotinoids and crops and working with the sort of the rural area around the agriculture in particular. So we'll start with Peter.
As far as the water's concerned, the good news is we use a lot less water and we're rapidly using a lot less water. And I think we'll probably survive on that. It's not an area that the mayor can influence. I would love it if we could survive without growth, but we live in a country and we live in a society where that is governed by mainly by the population. And so we've got to house people and feed people. But I think there are other things we can do to look at how consumption is addressed. Highways. All I want to do is actually make the highways rational. There are just too many silly gaps in the roads. But in terms of adding volume, I don't think there's actually any need. Generally speaking, when you build roads, all you do is generate traffic. So I don't actually see much need for that. What you have to do, though, is be really much smarter about where you locate things, which is why I keep going on about building two or three large new towns, not scattering them all over the county, because that way you can actually put good transport links in that are effective. Scattering them around, all you do is just spread misery and unsustainability. I actually own a farm, and we no longer use neonicotinoids, if I got the right name. But it isn't an organic farm, and it won't be, because the impact on yields is so high. It is a constant challenge to work out what is best, because we actually have to look at the price of food as well, the price of food, the quality of the food, and the quality of the environment. This is really outside the mayoral side, but all I can say is it is an unbelievably difficult question, and I don't think there are any right answers to it. We just have to do the best we can with the science we have.
Peter, James.
Thank you very much. I'm a bit confused with the water question. We had Peter to my left here not 5 minutes ago telling us the whole of the Fens were going to flood and we were going to have too much water. Then we have a question to say we're not going to have enough water. I think probably my position would be somewhere in the middle of that, which is just enough water but not too much. Influence on Highways England. I'm not going to be very popular with you, sir, because I totally believe we need new roads in this county. And going around this county, if you get into the rural areas, they will tell you they are in desperate need of new roads in this county. It's imperative that we link our county north to south properly. Now, the fact is this should have been done 30 years ago, but that's why we need a mayor to stand up for these rural communities. They're desperate to get from the centre of this county down to the A14, down the M11, get into London. We've already heard that 37% of the vegetables are used in the UK are grown on soil in the Fens, and of course they need to be transported around. So yes, we do need better highways, we need faster highways. I don't agree with the belief the more roads you have, the more traffic you will create in certain areas. I believe actually expansion of the road network will improve the lot of most of the people in this county who do not have the ability to live in a city. As I said, if you get up to Ely and Littleport, they will tell you they are desperate for the A10 to be dualled. And that's right, they are desperate because it's a terrible road. If you go to Chatteris, March, Whittlesea, they just want to be connected to the rest of the county. And they want to have the opportunity to live and trade the same way as everybody else in the UK does. And they should deserve that right. Agriculture and neonicotine. I was a farmer for 25 years and I studied at agricultural college. When I was at agricultural college, it was when trials for GM crops started.
and those GM crops were torn up, and it became a massive agenda, public agenda, and I think it's hugely to the detriment of this country that those GM crops were torn up. If you want to grow sustainable crops without using neonicotines, if you want to grow sustainable crops using the safest spray, somebody mentioned earlier, insecticides with bees, GM crops are the way forward. They're great for this country, but they're also great for poor nations as well. It was a huge step backwards for science when GM crops were destroyed and taken out of the off the agenda. And I've always felt it was a disaster for the UK, but more particularly a disaster for emerging nations. So my answer to you, madam, is that we should be going back into the agenda for GM crops, and that would be the way forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Jeremy.
Thank you. Whether the world has enough water to accommodate the growth that's going to happen is something that I'm sceptical of. I have to say I'm not. I think there are other parts of the world and other parts of the country that are worse off than our region in terms of ensuring our water supply. But in terms of building sustainable homes, then clearly using water sustainably is an important part of that. We've known for literally decades that it doesn't work to build more roads, that actually congestion is not reduced if you just build more roads, it just generates more traffic. And in terms of the large number of road schemes and what influence the mayor will have with the highways agency, if he or she is trying to stop it, I suggest probably not much. But given what we were saying in the last batch of questions about the natural resources of our region, then sticking ever more parts of our county and our region under tarmac is not the right thing to do. As far as neonicotinoids, the pesticides that are implicated in killing bees, the European Union is in the process or has banned their use. Our government, encouraged by the National Farmers Union, has done everything that they can to squeeze out from under that by having temporary exceptions and things like that. One of the many things that worries me about Brexit is that we will lose that protection. In terms of whether GM crops are the answer to that, GM crops are simply a way of delivering poor farmers in developing countries into the hands of Monsanto and other large firms.
Thank you. Rod.
So in relation to water, I think there is a big problem. I think that if you look in Cambridge, there's been some quite extensive research done in terms of the availability of water as the city grows. I think there is a major opportunity for the mayor to influence the use of water. Remember, the mayor has at their hands 100 million to spend on affordable housing, and they can influence how that housing is built, they can influence it in terms of the use of the water, and they can make sure that actually they deliver sustainable homes, something along the BREEA home quality mark, for example, using, you know, recycled water, all those types of features. So there is an opportunity. And actually, as a city council, we kind of led the way. Over a decade ago, my colleague Sean Reed introduced some really imaginative concepts in terms of new developments and the use of water in those new developments. And I think that's an opportunity for the mayor across the region using that concept. In terms of highways, England, the simple answer to the question is the mayor needs to develop, in conjunction with residents and other key stakeholders, an integrated transport strategy for the region. We can't keep tarmacking. You can't keep tarmacking. It's as simple as that. Any sensible transport planner will tell you that you need all modes of transport. You need buses, you need rail, you need cycling, pedestrian, and yes, to a certain degree, cars. But actually, I disagree with some of my colleagues
in terms of buses not having any use. And let me just give you the illustration. I was in Gunthorpe, which is in Peterborough, the other day, and I was talking to a lady, and this concept of community bus, let me give you the illustration. I think she was in her 70s. She had to call the bus to go to the doctors. It took 2 hours to come. She goes to the doctors. She's not sure how long she's going to be in the doctors, so she can't call the bus to take her back home at the time she calls the bus to take her to the doctor. She has to wait till she's seen the doctor. She then waits 2 more hours to go home. Her conclusion? I don't go and see the doctor. I get the doctor to come and see me. So that just is the practical illustration of where we are with buses in rural communities. And actually, not everybody drives. Young people who are under the age of 17, they don't drive. Old people typically don't drive either. And I think that is a major issue in terms of some of our rural communities. And the bus solution is a good solution. It connects those people. It connects those people. So I think that's something which would certainly need to be part of an integrated transport strategy. In relation to the crops, I would echo the point made that actually Brexit will cause material impacts on agriculture across the region. There is an opportunity for this government because as we step out of the common agricultural policy, we can target funding in a way that is positive for the environment in terms of farmers. And I think that's something which should be welcomed. But it is very frightening in terms of some of the supposed points being made by national politicians in terms of them seeing it as an opportunity to roll back a lot of the legislation. And I don't know if you've seen the manifesto for Greener UK. I think there is a very good platform of a number of key stakeholders nationally that are committed to make sure the government does not do that, that actually they hold the government to account in terms of maintaining some of the policies that basically we've benefited from for over 40 years. I think that was it.
Yep. Kevin.
Yes, thank you. I have a friend that I've known for 35 years who's been telling me throughout that time that there isn't enough water in Cambridge and Cambridgeshire, but certainly when I used to talk to him earlier in the early days, it was more about Cambridge. And a lot of that is to do with the way all of us use water without thinking. 3/4 of us apparently fill our kettles too full, and that, you know, is not only a waste of water, but it's of course a waste of energy when you're heating more water in a kettle than you need. So it's about, an element of it is about education. We have to get across to people that we all think it rains here all the time. You know, everybody's moaning about it's always raining, but we're one, as has already been said, you know, we are one of the driest parts of Europe, so I was told earlier today. So I think we have to do, and I mentioned this housing, sustainable housing guide, where we're planning on using these, what was the sustainable homes level 4 for energy and water, for instance, so that water is used in a much better way within the home. You know, water meters where we'll sort of concentrate the mind a bit and people will be, in the end, using less water than they do now. Influence on the Highways Agency. I mean, I would hope that the mayor is going to have some influence on the Highways Agency, and I'm in agreement with some of my fellow candidates here that building more roads is not the answer. More tarmac is not the answer. What would be good would be to improve some of the roads that we've already got, but I think nationally to improve the roads is going to cost some £12 billion if we were to put the roads back into some decent form of use. But the need, you know, our needs are wider than just people in cars. Now, I've got a car, I use a car. I've got a bike, I use a bike. I mean, I'm very fortunate. I live in Cambridge. It means I can cycle around quite easily. But, you know, if we have proper connectivity between villages and towns, more and more people will be using their bikes. And on the question of neonicotinoids, I understand why farmers would be concerned about their yields, but that's really, really a short-term view, in that you can be concerned about your yields now, but if, for instance, if you're killing off the very things that help your plants grow, eventually it's not going to happen. You know, they're not going to be. So we have to be looking longer term, and it's not going to be in the mayor's remit or power, I suppose, to ban neonicotinoids. But the mayor is going to have influence, is going to be speaking on behalf of the combined authority, is going to be able to lobby government, is going to have to stand up to government and say, look, this needs to happen. We need these things to happen in the areas of sort of Cambridgeshire and Peterborough.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you. So I'm going to, we're sort of running out of time. We've got 10 minutes left. So if I can ask the panel to keep the responses brief, we'll take, try and squeeze in two more rounds of questions, one from Peterborough, and then we'll take one from the virtual environment on Twitter. So there are three questions from Peterborough. One around homes, and in particular, sort of future new build homes, retrofit, emissions, and fuel poverty. So if you wanted to talk a little bit about your vision for the type of homes that we should be building, and in particular how that might link into emissions or fuel poverty. The other one is energy production. So any ideas around energy production? There was a specific question around energy from waste, and I know a couple have mentioned energy from waste already. And then another question which has come in advance, but also was reiterated at the Peterborough end, was around the Cambridge-Peterborough balance. So how do we ensure that there is balance in terms of investment or priorities between Cambridge and Peterborough? So to start off this round, if I can go to Jeremy.
Thank you. Programs of retrofitting insulation and things like that, I think are clearly going to be necessary if we're going to hit our targets. The government is committed by the Climate Change Act to reducing emissions from homes by 80% by 2050. We are clearly going to have to work quite hard, very hard, to do that, which is why abandoning the requirement that it was introduced by Gordon Brown in 2006, that all new homes by 2016 would have to be zero carbon. Now, the homes that are being built now are still going to be occupied in 2050, so that was a really bad idea, abandoning that target and that aspiration. Secondly, in terms of energy production, I think this isn't in the mayor's remit, I will admit, but the current push, for example, to build new nuclear plants such as Hinkley, is completely mad. Spending that much money and paying that much for the electricity when it comes, if the renewable sector was given a deal like that, our problems would be solved. And thirdly, the balance between Cambridge and Peterborough. Yes, I think that is a really tricky issue. I mean, I've lived in both places, and they are very different. And yoking them together in the way that this mayoral deal has done strikes me as a deeply odd thing to do.
Thank you, Rod.
So, in relation to the first question, which was homes and new build, and fuel poverty. I think we do have a good illustration here in the city, which I touched on earlier, the 200 sustainable homes being built on the southern fringe, 50% of which are affordable. And the goal of the City Council in terms of that development was to take a very specific approach, which was to set the bar high, to demonstrate to commercial developers that you can have a viable development with high spec sustainable homes. And what does that do for those residents who are living there? Their fuel bills are cut almost to zero. So if you think of those people who are living in affordable houses, and you know, we call them affordable homes in Cambridge, but the reality is that for the majority of people, they struggle to actually rent affordable homes in this city. You know, a 20% discount to the market rent is not affordable in this city. And I've lobbied for a local living rent, which would be based on a third of their income. So people who would live in those homes would have disposable income, and those homes would enable them to save money in terms of bills. So I think there is already there in place an example of how we can do that across the region. That's the first point. The second point is on energy production. I would like to see the mayor to actually, on a regional basis, come up with some creative ideas for energy cooperatives so that actually one can pool the actual resources of the region in terms of sustainable energy and in terms of energy purchasing in a way that actually delivers those benefits to residents across the region in terms of their fuel bills. The third point in relation to Cambridge and Peterborough balance. Look, as mayor, I want to be the mayor for everybody across the region. You know, there are many voices across this region, whether you live in Cambridge or Peterborough or Wisbeach or Huntingdon or St. Neots. There are many different voices. But actually, all those different voices have generally the same issues. They want a decent job with money in their pocket. They want a good, affordable, an affordable quality home in which they can live in a community they feel part of, not bricks and mortar, and they want good, reliable, cheap public transport. And it doesn't matter if you live in Cambridge or you live in Peterborough or anywhere. Those are, when you talk to people, those are the things that people are looking for. So I don't think one should characterize Peterborough or Cambridge as two, you know, challenging cities. We should look at the region as one. That's the decision that's been taken in terms of this devolution package. And as mayor, I want to represent everybody across the region.
Thank you. Kevin.
Yes, thank you. On the first one, the homes and new build. Now, this particular devolution deal is quite unique amongst all the devolution deals, in that there was a good... there was £100 million for affordable housing across the Cambridgeshire and Peterborough area, largely built through housing associations. But there was another part of that deal, which was £70 million ring-fenced for Cambridge City Council to build council houses, to be able to build houses for the people in the city that cannot afford to buy, that cannot afford to rent privately. And those homes, and again, I refer to this as housing sustainability document, they will be built to the highest specifications we can, because they need to be well insulated so that so that fuel bills are low, so that water costs are low. So that's the sort of house that will be built by Cambridge City Council in Cambridge. We would like to roll the same sorts of standards out across the other homes across Cambridgeshire and Peterborough that will be built with that £100 million. On the energy production, it has to be about renewable energy. It's already been said here that the mayor will have no say or influence over what national government does in terms of nuclear power, but you know, I'm pretty certain that we could make a good old fist of pointing out that that's probably not the right way to go. Well, we know it's not the right way to go, and it's not the way I would want us to go. And the Cambridge-Peterborough balance. Now, I've already said about that unique housing deal, the housing deal for Cambridge, that came about because we were negotiating through this, the early stages, for Cambridge. That was something we stood out for, we held out for, because we wanted money for the least well-off in Cambridge to be able to house people on low incomes, to stop them having to move further away and then have to travel back into work. I would put that same energy and that same drive into standing up for the region as a whole. I would stand up for Peterborough, I would stand up for the whole of Cambridgeshire in the same way as I stood up for Cambridge.
Thank you, Kevin. Peter.
With homes, basically the problem is we haven't got enough homes. We're not talking about a few hundred homes here, we're talking about tens of thousands of homes that we're short. And the only way we can deliver those is through modular homes and building them out there. I've set up a consortium, catalyzed, I guess, that is proposing to build a factory in Fenland, taking jobs there, turning out 20 homes a day that can be ferried down into Peterborough, into Cambridge, and elsewhere where they're needed. This way we can build lots of houses. Building them on government land, such as the airfields, means that actually the land costs can be brought low as well. Now, there is a consequence to solving the housing crisis. The value of your houses can go down as well as up. Your rents could go down if you're a landlord. But what we will do is solve the housing problem, but we've got to do it with tens of thousands, and that's what I would endeavour to do. When it comes to energy production, the wind turbines are now pretty familiar on the Fen. Personally, I don't find them offensive at all, and I would encourage that we increase that significantly. But by far the biggest contribution to energy would be a barrier across the Wash, which could turn out as much energy as a good-sized nuclear power station. Now, finally, coming to the differences between Cambridge and Peterborough, actually, the differences with all of our communities is actually great. And I actually don't think that I, as mayor, could actually hold that number of views in my head. So what I've proposed is that I would recruit either voluntary or maybe current councillors or other people, mini mayors for St Neots and Wisbeach and Warboys and what have you. And they will be my eyes and ears. I've already recruited someone in Peterborough to help me get a handle on it, and it's been invaluable. And we are already making significant changes in Peterborough, which I hope to announce shortly, by working with people. And that's what we've got to do. But they've got to be people who are doers, not talkers. Not people who will write a policy, but will deliver the goods. And that's what I intend to do, deliver the goods.
Thank you, Peter. James.
Thank you. The lovely thing about these hustings is I learn from time to time. Well, this is the third one I've done. So on Tuesday, I learned that the Liberal Democrat candidate backed my ambition to build an underground and light railway, which was great. Tonight, I've learned that the Labour candidate backs East Cam's policy for community land trust housing. Community land trust housing is a fantastic option, one of the options that I will spread out through the county should I become mayor. And I'll just explain to you shortly, for a short while, just how it works. We've got one up and running in Streatham near Ely at the moment. It's 70 houses, 33% of which are low cost in a sustainable location, built to sustainable values, exactly the same quality houses as the market houses on the system. Built outside the planning envelope, but the uplift in the value of the land pays for the houses. So we have got plans in East Cambs for 335 of these houses currently, and they will be at zero cost to the taxpayer.
compare and contrast that, 500 council houses in Cambridge, £70 million. So you can see why this scheme is exciting for me, and it's providing proper affordable houses. The market rent in Streatham is coming in at just under 70%, and there's also a rent-to-buy option as well. Wherever you live in Cambridgeshire, these schemes can be achieved. They are in conjunction with the local people. The trusts are set up in local towns, villages or cities, and they are a success and they are working now. Not something that might happen or could happen. This is something that's happening now that I will bring forward across the whole of the county. Again, the second question, I don't think anybody has answered the question, because the question was, how do you achieve getting energy from waste? And I already stated earlier how I foresee that picking up rubbish from our homes, taking it to a tip in the centre of Cambridgeshire, tipping it up, sorting it, tipping it back into landfill or selling some of it off isn't really a 21st century answer. There has to be a better answer. We've seen it in Europe and we can see it in the UK. Incineration and AD plants, providing energy for homes that are close to them, is a sensible way forward. It's much more economical and it's much more viable, environmentally viable, and it's a sensible answer. So I'm afraid I'm the only one that's answered that, but I've answered it twice now as well. Cambridgeshire and Peterborough, well, you might think they're different, but in actual fact, they've got a lot in common, and I'll tell you why they've got a lot in common. They're both very successful cities in their own right. Peterborough's got a very strong economy. It's got an unlike Cambridge, it's got an outstanding network of roads. I'm sorry again to those of you that dislike them, but it has. Getting around the city is fantastically easy, and that's something that Cambridge can learn from Peterborough. Cambridge has got an immense world economy, and Peterborough wants to share in that immense world economy. But it can only share in that incredible world economy if we connect the cities together and the towns and villages in between. So yes, it's sustainable. Yes, we connect through rail and light rail, but yes, we connect through roads as well. We have to give the people every option necessary to run their businesses, to get to and from work, to travel back and forth across the county. And the mayor is mayor for Cambridgeshire and Peterborough, and I disagree that Peterborough should not be part of this. I think it absolutely should. And only as a whole county can we truly sell this product across the world and be top of the list for international business.
Thank you, James. So thank you all the candidates for those are the sort of rounds of questions. We've checked on Twitter and there are no key areas that are missing in terms of the questions. What I will ask the candidates to do now is you have a minute to come back on anything that any of the other candidates have said or anything that you want to have a closing thought on. If we can keep it to a minute because we're already over and people have got places to go. There are still lots of questions out there. Hopefully if some of the candidates are around afterwards you might be able to ask them on a one-on-one basis, but if we start with James.
The mayor is an ear to government and an ear to people of Cambridgeshire. Only one candidate in this room has a ear of government. Only one candidate in this room is meeting regularly with cabinet ministers. Only one candidate in this room is constantly shouting for Cambridgeshire at all times to the people who need to listen. This is a massive opportunity for Cambridgeshire. It is life-changing for this community. We can change it for the better. We can clearly put Cambridgeshire at top of the tree for international business and trade, where it absolutely deserves to be. Thank you, sir. You can vote for me as well if you'd like to. This is the time that Cambridgeshire can stand up and be counted, but it needs somebody to stand up for it. I am the person that can do that.
Thank you, James. Jeremy.
Thank you. Councillor Palmer was enumerating a few minutes ago what he thought of as his policies that other candidates supported. I've been quite encouraged by the support for renewable energy and sustainable housing and so forth that we've heard about this evening from the other speakers. My conclusion would be simply this: don't get your green policies secondhand.
We've had 20 years of local government not delivering.
And Cambridge and indeed Cambridgeshire has actually had an awful lot of ministerial visits over the years as well. Personally, I think we've got to address our own problems and get on with it. That's what I do in my life. That's what I've been doing with the initiatives that I've done personally in Cambridge. I believe that with the powers and the funds, I can work with you to deliver a better Cambridge for all of us. And I'd like you to vote for me. Thank you.
Kevin.
Yes, thank you. James, what I when I said about community land trusts, and I said they are, as far as I'm concerned, just a part of it. They are 10 to 15% of East Cam's housing. So it is a part of it, and that was the point I was making, that is a valid part, but it is not a great big part, and it probably won't work all over. I'd just say, where the Conservative candidate tells you he's got the ear of government and he has access to government ministers, there is only one candidate here that has had, who has been in with government ministers and has stood up to government ministers, which is why Cambridge City Council got £70 million for building council housing, because we stood up to them. They didn't want council. Everything that the government had been saying for some time told you that they don't want council housing. So why then did Cambridge get that unique deal? I'll tell you why, because I stood up to the government. Didn't roll over, I didn't do what the government wanted, stood up to them. And that is what I will bring as Mayor of Cambridgeshire and Peterborough, somebody that will stand up to government.
So just a response in relation to light rail, because I think light rail is an interesting it's an interesting opportunity in terms of sustainable transport, and it's something that I've been involved in for 18 months as we look at the bus corridor coming from the west and looking at other alternatives to the current proposals put forward by the Greater City Deal. And it's interesting that the Conservative members of the board who vote have not even considered funding an exploratory project to see whether or not light rail can be validated. So it depends where you get on in terms of the journey and which station. And I can assure you, I got on at the station which was at the start of the line, not about three quarters down the track. And if you're interested and you do have a view, then go to my website and look at the survey. Because actually, I'd like to know your views on light rail. I think it's a really interesting idea. It's not my idea. Cambridge Connect have a fantastic idea, and it needs to be validated. And the Greater City Deal could have an opportunity to invest just a little money to see whether or not it would work. They're doing it for other schemes like the bullet bus, so why can't they do it for light rail? Finally, what I've heard this evening in the questions is that all of you here in Cambridge and in Peterborough are passionate about the environment. You're passionate about wanting to protect it and preserve it and enhance it. And it's a very simple message that I want to leave with you. If you want a mayor that's going to be with you on that journey, then you need to vote for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you. So thank you for each of the candidates in responding to your questions. Thank you for your opening comments and your closing comments. Before I hand back to Anne for some final thoughts, I just wanted to just say a few parting things of myself. At the GSI, we've enjoyed working with each of the parties that are represented here, including the Independent, over the last few years. I've chaired groups on infrastructure investment for the Conservative government, the Minister of Climate Change. We've done quite a lot with them in government. We did lots with Labour when they were in power around climate change and the Climate Change Act in particular. I was the student rep for the Lib Dems in Cambridge 25 years ago. We've done lots of reports for the Green MEPs around some of the investment and quantitative easing as well. And Peter is one of the largest donors to the GSI in terms of our research. So whoever wins, and whichever party, I think there is obviously an ongoing conversation around environment and sustainability and routes in and ways of working with any of the parties or the independent mayor going forward. There are common ground that we can find, and there's ways of building vision. So it's partly about the language. We've heard lots of questions around energy, around housing, around transport. Some of those are in direct control of the mayor. Some of those, as we've also heard, will be part of the influence that the mayor will bring, representing such an important part of not just this region, but the entire country, both in Cambridge and in Peterborough. And the environment and sustainability sector, both for Peterborough being environment city, and the environment sector in Peterborough being a huge growth area and large economic area for Peterborough. The rural areas we have in terms of agricultural production at its very heart is around sustainability, environment, of course, and Cambridge with Cambridge Cleantech, and the growth area around technology development, creating jobs, then the economic opportunities, as well as the sort of counter to that around making sure that economic development is as sustainable as possible, will obviously be an important discussion, important dialogue that we can start with whoever is elected on May the 5th onwards. In terms of the GSI, if you want to know more about us, we've got So What magazines at the front, which is our latest magazine around, this one is on the future. We try not to be that pessimistic, but my nickname is Dr. Apocalypse. So, also we just skip over the bit I've written and go to the more positive ways of thinking about the future. Your vote will be very important, and I have just checked, which I said incorrectly, someone then second preference votes are also very important, so think about how you use your vote, first and second, coming up on May the 4th. Please do go out and vote. So thank you for coming to Anglia Ruskin. I'll now hand over to Anne.
Well, I found that a really, really interesting evening. And thank you, everybody, for some great questions. And thank you, all candidates, and all the people here who have been helping make it all work. I hope it's all been working really well for you over in Peterborough. So, as Aled said, key thing is go and vote. 4th of May, get your friends to vote. If anybody hasn't actually registered, you have until the 13th of April to go and register to vote. Secondly, continue, there are two follow-up events by Cambridge Carbon Footprint together with Paul Allen of the Inspiring Centre for Alternative Technology, which might be of interest to you. The first is on the 28th of April, and it's been described as both fascinating and inspiring. It's a multimedia event called The Extraordinary Story of Human Beings, Energy and Happiness, in which Paul Allen is accompanied by images and the wonderful live pianist that some of you may have heard last year, Lola Perrin. It is the 27th. Thank you. Thank you. The second event is on Friday the 28th, which is a presentation and workshop on Zero Carbon Britain, Making It Happen. And this is aimed at bringing together thinkers, community groups and academics from different disciplines to share the expertise and ideas about how to make it happen here in Cambridge and our wider devolved region. And that event is actually also here in Anglia Ruskin. So you can find more of details of those events and the correct times when they actually are on the CCF stall outside, or just talk to one of the CCF volunteers in T-shirts. So we can continue informal discussions till 8 o'clock or shortly thereafter. We're just going to take a quick photograph of the candidates together and then they'll be with you. And finally, it is a free event, but donations in aid of Cambridge Carbon Footprint are very much appreciated to help them continue their work. And I think there will shortly be some volunteers with some buckets at the doors. But anyhow, see you later. And some of us, I'm sure, will be going to the tram depot pub over the way afterwards. Thank you very much.